Let's begin with a song. Turn in your hymnals, please, to hymn number 380, Higher Ground. I don't know if you paid attention to this song as we sing it, but it's talking about our journey. I'm pressing on. I'm pressing forward. I want to move to higher ground. That is, as I walk with the Lord, to be in a better position to walk with Him. Let's sing that together. 380, Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's tableland. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet service about to start. Sometimes I've just got so many things going through my head, and I just completely threw the whole order of service off. So sorry, Whitney and Donna and Lynn. I make a bulletin for them, even though we don't hand it out to everybody anymore. And I'm sorry, I just completely went off script. But we'll get back on script as far as that goes. First of all, I'd like to welcome you here. I hope you had a good Thanksgiving. I hope that things have gone well. I don't know about you, but I've been enjoying seeing the snow melt and seeing more and more bare ground. I've still got things I'm trying to do outside, so that's been good. But I hope that you had a good Thanksgiving and a good weekend leading up to this. Let me get into some announcements. We have a number of different things, and actually I've got a whole list of a bunch of things. First of all, you may have noticed that the food is still on the back pew from our food shower. We've still been accepting donations for that. We actually do have a couple families that we're going to be giving them to. However, it didn't work out with either one of them for us to get them to them before Thanksgiving. So instead of it helping with their Thanksgiving dinner, we're hoping now that it'll help as far as leading into Christmas time and so forth. But we are planning on still delivering some of that, some of it this week, and I think some of it's going to have to wait for even another week after that. That's a whole story, so I'm not going to go into the whole thing about that. But thank you for giving. Thank you for bringing in food, and we will be getting them to them. I know some of them we're going to be taking home with us today to deliver to someone. I think tomorrow is when we're actually getting that to them. All right, a few other things. Ladies, remind you that the next ladies' book study is going to be on Saturday, December 10th. And we have questions out on the table if you need them. For that, to prepare for the study. And Secret Sisters, those of you that have been involved with the Secret Sisters group, the reveal is going to be on Saturday, December 10th, there at the ladies' Bible study. If you can't be there for that, see Whitney, and she'll get you all set up and take care of those things. But most of the ladies who come to the study are involved with that. And just keep in mind, the reveal will be for that. So you have one more week to get a gift beforehand, unless you want to actually give it to them on that day. But keep that in mind, ladies. The next day, Sunday the 11th, is officially when we're having our church elections. And the only office we have up for election would be the office of deacon. However, we have two deacons now, and neither one of their terms are up, so we don't really have to vote anyone in. But if you as members want to nominate someone for the office of deacon, you could still do that. There's time, and then we could consider voting on them for December 11th. However, what you need to do is you need to go to the Constitution and see what the qualifications are. There's, of course, biblical qualifications, but there's also technical qualifications for that. And just look those things up, and then if you still want to nominate someone, you could write it on a slip of paper and put it in the brown box out on the information table, and then I will take that. And what I do is I then approach that person and see if they are willing to have their name put up there. So if we end up not voting on anyone and you're wondering why, because you nominated someone, well, it's probably because they decided that they didn't want to run for that. So that's the process, though. So if you want to nominate someone, put it in the box out there on the table. All right, a few other things. We have our progressive dinner coming up. We haven't done it for the last couple of years because of the whole COVID situation, but we are going to do the progressive dinner this year. And Paul and Kim are heading that up. We already have people who are handling the hors d'oeuvres and then the main course and then the dessert. And we're going to be in three different places for those things. But we have a sign-up sheet out here if you want to be involved. We really need you to sign up so that the people preparing the meals will know how many people to plan for. So please see that and sign up for that if you would, please. And then our main Christmas program. Yes, it's after Thanksgiving, so we're going to start talking more about Christmas stuff. Our main Christmas program is going to be on Sunday, December 18th. That's the week before Christmas. And we're going to do what we've done the past many years and do what's called Christmas in Story and Song. I think it's always neat once so many of you volunteer to do different things. Then we put it all together and make a program out of it. To me, it's one of the most enjoyable Sundays of the year. So we're planning on doing that. There is a sign-up sheet out there. Carl. Okay. And since Carl's the main Sunday school teacher, that carries some weight. So I agree. That would be good. So on Sunday the 18th, we will not have Sunday school so that we can prepare for the program. But and then we will not be having Sunday school the next week because it's Christmas Day. We will have a morning service, but not Sunday school. Now, as far as the story and song, there's a sign-up sheet out here, and I need you to do two things. If you want to participate, first of all, put your name down, and then tell me what it is you're planning on doing. If you want to sing a song, tell me what the song is. If you want to read a passage, tell me what the passage is. Or if you have something else you want to do, read a story or be involved in something else, tell me what that is. And the reason I want that is because I then take all that information, I put it in an orderly service, so there's a flow to it. And it always turns out beautiful. I always enjoy it. But you need to be involved, and you need to do that. And if you're not, then all the people who just became new members are going to be assigned things. So, no, I'm kidding. That's a joke. Tom Snyder came in last week. We told him he was special music for the day. So, but no, we would like as many of you to be involved as possible. And then that'll make that Sunday a special time. So keep that in mind. Now, with that said, we are going to have a Christmas Eve service this year, even though the next day is Christmas morning, is a Sunday service. We're going to have a Christmas Eve service and a Sunday morning service. So write that down. And the reason we're going to keep doing the Christmas Eve service, there's a number of people that have family that come in from out of town, and they'd like to have a service. So we're going to have a Christmas Eve service. And by the way, if you haven't been to one, it's really pretty. We push the pews together. We have Christmas lights everywhere. We turn off all these lights. And it's just a pretty service with the Christmas lights lighting up the auditorium. And sometimes we do candlelight, sometimes we don't. But if you would remember, put that on your calendar. And if it works into your schedule, we'd love to see you for the Christmas Eve service. And then Sunday morning, that next service, the next morning, I'm just going to make it an extension of the Christmas Eve service. But we'll just have the morning service at 11, and we won't have Sunday school or afternoon service that particular day. So you should be able to get all your presents open by 11 o'clock Sunday morning. Okay, now I've got a number of other announcements that aren't involving dates. First of all, the church directory, we're still taking pictures for that. Lynn and Whitney are trying to get that together. If you haven't had your picture taken yet and you want to be in the directory, and if you're a normal person here, well, let me rephrase that. If you're a regular person here, we want you in our directory. You don't have to be a member to be in our directory. You just have to be someone who's here on a regular basis. And we would like you to be in that. See them afterwards. They're taking pictures in the Sunday school room. And they would like to get them done by next week. So if you haven't had your picture yet, which the Wagners haven't had their picture taken yet either, but if you want to do that, see Lynn and Whitney after the service, and they'll make sure that you get that. Now, I've got a number of prayer requests here and a few other announcements I want to mention. Lynn and I went over yesterday and saw Joanne Miller over in Traverse City. Her spirits are beautiful, by the way. She's really doing well as far as her spirits are going. She knows that she's dying. In fact, when we got there, she said, "I'm assuming you come here to talk to me about my funeral." We said, "No, that's not why we're here." But she's really upbeat about that. She wants to honor the Lord, so we're grateful for that. And she said, "Pass on to the church that I love them. I love so many of them." She mentioned some of you by names, but she said all of you. She appreciates you so much. And she wants you to pray. Pray that when her funeral does come up, that it would honor the Lord. But also, she pray for her family. There's a few difficulties as far as, you know, when you have things like this going on, plus the normal family dynamic to boot, there can be issues at times. So pray for her family. She would appreciate that, that they would come together and be unified during this whole time. We want you to pray for Angie's still got some upcoming things dealing with her doctors and so forth. And so pray for them. I know I don't have all the dates and all that stuff right now, but pray for them that they'd have wisdom. No dates right now. Okay, so we'll just pray that the doctors would have wisdom and that you guys would have wisdom as well. They would appreciate that. Randy and Linda are here. Randy had to go into the emergency this week. Had some issues with his eyes, got some stuff in his eyes that scratched his eyes. He's doing better, though, from what I understand. Yeah, there you go. But pray for them. He would appreciate that. I'm sure of that. And then Lois Savola's here. Rich is normally at her side. Rich isn't here today, but Rich and Beth's daughter, Christy, out in Kansas, right, had surgery a little while ago, and it didn't go well. Her body didn't respond well to the surgery, and there's still issues with that. And on top of that, she came down with COVID. The COVID is now, she's beyond that, thankfully, from what we understand, but there's still complications from the surgery. So be praying for Christy. I know that Rich and Beth would appreciate that, so that would be good. And then one last thing, Carl and Marge Schreiner are celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary. Isn't that something? Who do you congratulate more, Carl or Marge? Marge, but they both endured this time with each other. And there's going to be a celebration on January 7th, I believe it is. I've got all the information out on the bulletin board. And their daughters are putting the celebration together. It's going to actually be at the Days Inn conference room here at the hotel in town on that day. But see the information, and if you want to send best wishes or anything like that, there's information on that will give you directions on how to do those things. And there's a date, they have an RSVP date on there. I can't remember what it was, but it's coming up within the next week or two. So yes, if you think you'll show up for that, it's going to be like an open house type of a deal. Let them know, that helps them plan. So they would appreciate that. So congratulations, Carl. Now, I've been going through, I've got a lot of things here. I think I've said anything. Is there anything that I've missed? Anybody have anything? Paul. Well, actually, we may do that this afternoon, those of us that stay for the afternoon service. It would either be this afternoon or Wednesday. I'm still That's one of those things swirling around in my head that I'm trying to quite figure out. But by next Sunday, we're hoping it'll look Christmassy in here, and we'll actually be singing some Christmas songs. So, with that said, let's move on with our service now. Let's do some singing together. We've got a couple songs, Before the Throne of God Above and Be Strong in the Lord.
Protect you wherever.
Turn in your Bibles for a moment to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5. We've been studying Peter's letter. And sometimes there's people in Christendom that want to make more of what Peter said or make more of what Paul said. But Paul and Peter are together on these things that we've been looking at. You can find in both of their letters, they're both touching on these subjects. And last week we looked at the idea of families that are in this situation where there might be hostilities arising in the world. How are we to live? And we looked at the wife's role last week. Well, today we're going to look at the husband's role. And so I'm going to begin that in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. Paul says, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave the father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband." We will look more at these things from Peter's perspective as the morning goes. Let's pray. Father, again, thank you for bringing us together this morning. Thank you that we have the freedom in this country to come and celebrate our faith and worship you as we believe you have led us to do so. And we're grateful that we have those freedoms. Lord, if for whatever reason those freedoms are ever taken from us, I pray that you would give us wisdom and help us to know how we should respond and how we as the body of Christ react to those things. And we're grateful that we're not there yet, but if it ever does, help us to think through those things. And now, Father, as we move forward in our service, may you be honored and glorified. And I pray that you'd open all of our hearts to understand the things that you have provided for us today. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing one more song, and then as we sing this song, the kids will be dismissed to head back into the Sunday school room. Let's sing this one, "The Steps of a Good Man." This is from the book of Psalms, actually. Thank you. Are the kids not being dismissed today? They are being dismissed? Okay. I don't know everything that's going on all the time. So, kids, you may be dismissed to your classroom.
Thank you very much.
And for the rest of you, turn to 1 Peter, if you would. 1 Peter chapter 3. Maybe it's leftover turkey and gravy, but I feel tense today. But that doesn't mean I'm going to be preaching a hellfire brimstone message. So there you go. But if we're in 1 Peter chapter 3, we're going to pick up where Peter's been talking about. Again, I believe he's writing to these believers that are in a part of the Roman Empire where they're going to start facing persecution. And he's telling them, as this comes on, here's how we are to represent the Lord. Here's how we are to live. And last week and this week, he's talking specifically about family relationships. I believe with the wife last week, he was saying, look, some of you have unsaved husbands. How do you present a gospel testimony to them? And so he gave some ideas on how they are to live and how they are to conduct themselves. Now, we're going to look at what he has to say to husbands. And the same thing might be true because he begins by saying, husbands likewise. So some husbands in this part of the world would have had unsaved wives as well, wives that weren't a part of the faith. And how do they live so that they could present a testimony to them? But even beyond all of that, he's talking to them, look, the world is watching. And as the world is going to, in their case, the world was going to begin persecuting them because it was already started in the Roman Empire. And as they persecute you and as they watch, here's how you need to live so that you're not compounding the problem, so that you're not making it worse. But even more importantly than that, so that you're representing the Lord as you do that. So today, he's going to talk about husbands. And where they're supposed to be. As we get into this, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for your word, and I pray that you would open up our hearts and minds today so that we can understand it. Father, there are passages that are difficult for us, that are hard to know exactly how to apply to ourselves, and the world certainly doesn't want to apply them in a godly way either, and so we struggle with that because we live in this world. But we just pray that you would give us wisdom, Father, and help us to be the people that you intend us to be so that we can carry out the task that you've left for us, no matter what our circumstances are, whether they're peaceful or whether they're in trying times. Help us to do that. I'm praying in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I promised I would tell you how husbands are to submit. Remember, I mentioned it last week. Sometimes when we look at these ideas about submission, we automatically just think of women, and we think of the idea that the Bible talks about women submitting to the leadership of their husbands, and that creates all kinds of negative stuff. But frankly, within Christianity, submission is a huge concept that we're all under. We all have to submit in many different ways. Even Carl, talking in a Sunday school class this morning, talking about he was looking at the tabernacle and the altar of incense and so forth. And one of the ideas came out that the reason we would smell those incenses, it reminds us that we are to submit to God and to what he has going on in our lives. And so submission is a huge thing. And there's lots of different relationships we have where we have to practice submission. So it's not only a wife's situation, but it's also a husband's situation. And I believe a husband has to submit. And we're going to look this week at specifically what that is. He's not submitting to his wife's headship because God has given him his headship. He can't even give his wife headship, even if he wanted to, because it's not his place to do it. That's not what God has done. So the husband's not submitting to his wife's headship. But instead, we're going to see, as Peter points out here, he's to submit to his wife's needs. And what it's going to do is create the right circumstances, going to create the right environment where they both can thrive together. And we will look at that. And he has to know her needs and to submit to her needs. So I'm in 1 Peter chapter 3. Let me read verse 7. Somebody said last week, ha, there's only one verse for husbands, and the wives had six verses. I don't think that means an awful lot. So let's look at this. But verse 7, he says, husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. Well, let's look at, first of all, he's saying, look, if you want your spiritual position to be right, if you want to be right before the Lord so your prayers aren't hindered, here's how you need to act. You have some things that are expected of you as well. So let's look at it. First of all, he says, husbands, give your wives understanding. There's probably a number of different translations out here today. I'm reading from the New King James. The King James said it this way, dwell with them according to knowledge. New King James said, dwell with them with understanding. And I actually looked up a bunch of other translations. Most of them had that same idea that was there. Do you remember the idea, or remember the movie Fireproof? Some of you would have watched the movie Fireproof. We actually showed it here in church as well. And in there, this husband and wife were having marital problems. And the one husband, he had gotten right with the Lord. He's trying to walk with the Lord. So now he's trying to help heal his marriage. And in there, he came across this concept. And he worded it this way. He said, it's like I'm supposed to earn a degree on my wife. You know, when we were dating, it was like I was earning my high school diploma. When we were engaged, maybe I then had my college degree. But now that we're married, I need to earn a PhD in wifeology. He didn't say it just like that, but that was the point he was getting at, is that I need to learn her. Well, that's what Peter's saying here. He doesn't say it in quite those words, but he needs to learn his wife. He says, dwell with them with understanding. You need to learn what your wife's needs are, and then therefore you need to live accordingly. Now, I'm going to try to balance all this off at the end, because this is one of those situations where the husband could say, all right, the wife's supposed to submit to me, and then he acts accordingly. Or the wife could say, well, you're supposed to submit to my needs, and then she acts accordingly. And if they both do that, it's going to mess it up. That's not the deal. And I'll tie that all in later, but let me just suffice it to say, husbands are never told to make their wives submit to their headship, and wives are never told to make their husbands submit to their needs. So it creates kind of a situation here. Remember, we are living a life of faith, and that's going to be part of the situation. But we'll look at this. Well, let me continue. This is a command. Dwell with them with understanding. It's a command. And the world says, no one can understand a woman, right? I mean, we all joke about that. We'll talk about that from time to time. I don't know if it's that the woman's so hard to understand, or that women are so hard, or that men are so hard to gain understanding. Which one? It is probably it. But God will not command you to do something that you can't do. It takes time, and it takes some study. Now, I've presented it before in Sunday school classes, but I had a list. It was called 50 Questions to Ask Your Wife. And there was also another one that said 50 questions to ask your husband. But in the 50 questions to ask your wife, the whole point was, in a counseling situation, is they were trying to help husbands to learn more about their wives. And some of them were very simple. Like, for instance, what's your favorite color? What's your wife's favorite color? Do you know what your wife's favorite color is? Well, you know what? I knew what it was when we got married, because that had to do with some of our wedding decorations. But I don't think it's the same color anymore. I think it's changed. So maybe I need to keep asking that question. Some of them could be, what's your favorite food? You might say, well, she fixes this all the time. No, that's probably because she knows you like it. Maybe that's not her favorite one. Maybe you should have asked that. I remember hearing a story one time in this case it was the husband's case, but the husband kept giving his wife the heel of bread from the loaf. And finally she got mad. She said, why do you keep giving me the heel? That is the most disgusting piece. And he said, actually, it was my favorite piece, and that's why I kept giving it to you. So you see, but they need to ask each other about that. They need to learn some things. Husbands, you need to learn those things. Well, what about other things? What about other questions that you can ask your wife? Do you know what your wife really wants to do next year? Do you know where she really wants to go on vacation next year? You might know where you might want to go, but have you asked her? Do you know other things? I could go on. These lists of questions, they were from a bunch of different categories. You can even get into more intimate questions about why a husband's asking their wives, what do their wives enjoy? What do they not enjoy? That type of a thing. We need to know those things, don't we? So we're not having a selfish relationship. It's more of an open relationship. We understand that type of a thing. Well, That list then goes on. There's another one that's then called, here are ways that you as a husband can express love to your wife. And part of it's based on what questions you might get answered in asking her about all these different things. But how can you express love to your wife? And there's, again, more practical ways. There's practical things like getting her a cup of coffee in the morning while she's getting ready. Helping her with whatever else that she wants done. Or how about you doing some things like doing the dishes when she's not doing them? Loading and unloading the dishwasher, vacuuming the carpet. And you know, I know some of you husbands do those things, and that's wonderful. But what things can we do that's helpful, that show love? Well, what about other things then beyond that? What about where you go out to eat when you want to go out to eat? What about the friends that you want to hang out with? Does your wife really like your friends? You know? You might laugh about it, but that there's some truth to that, isn't it? I mean, they might be your friends, but does she really enjoy spending time with them? You need to know those types of things, and then you need to express it. But we need to know what our wife's needs are. We need to know where our wife is, and then we need to ask those questions. Now, let me just stop now. My wife's not in the room. She's out in Sunday school. And I kind of wish she's going to be here, because I'm approaching this from, I feel really unqualified to be preaching this sermon, because I'm not very good at this. I'm not very good at asking those questions. I'm not very good at expressing those. Oh, there's things that I do. There's things that I can do to express affection and so on, but I'm not very good at it. And there's times that I really do feel like a failure. But I think that's life. And we need to keep moving forward. The difference is we're not given the option to just say, I'm no good at it, forget it, I'm not trying. We're not given that option. We're told to move forward with it. We're told to do that. So we have to keep going. So with me, I'll be honest with you, there was a moment when I thought, maybe I shouldn't preach this sermon this week. You know, as I thought this through. I've been kind of in conviction all week long as I've been looking over some of these things. But I can't do that. And I can't wait until I'm good at it, because if I did that, there'd be a lot of sermons I couldn't preach. You know, because we've all got to grow in those areas. But husbands, we need to learn about our wives. We need to know what are the things that they like, just common things. But what are the bigger things? What are the deeper things? What about those? We need to provide for them in all those things. We need to live in consideration of those things. Now, Peter's going to go on, and he's going to, I think, kind of elaborate a little bit on that. But he says, the husbands likewise dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel. Well, what's he mean by that? Giving honor to the wife as the weaker vessel. You got to be careful where you run with some of these things, because you could say a lot of things that Peter's not intending to say, and that the Holy Spirit's not tending to say. This isn't something that's saying that women are inferior to men. That has absolutely zero to do with anything. He's not saying that at all. In fact, he's going to go on later and talk about the fact that you are heirs together with the grace of life. So he's not saying that. What's he talking about? I think what he's talking about is, generally speaking, with men and women, men tend to be stronger, physically speaking, than women would be. Men tend to not react to things the way women react to things. So even emotionally speaking, there's a difference in the way that they do those things. Now, let me say this. I believe this is general, too. I believe there are cases I know of husbands and wives where the wife was physically stronger than the man. I get that. There's husbands and wives where the wife is emotionally stronger than the man. I mean, I understand all that. But we still need to put all this into context here. I believe in general, when it's talking about husbands and wives and the idea that she is the weaker vessel, I believe it's more of like this. You know, at home you've got your set of regular dinner plates, right? We've got our set that we eat, our everyday set in there. And I think you could take them and throw them up against the wall and they're not going to break, probably. You know, they're the old Corral ware, right? And, you know? But then you've got your nice dishes, your fancier dishes, your what I would call your I wouldn't even call them Sunday dishes, but I would call them your holiday dishes or something. They're nicer, and they do tend to be a little more delicate. But they serve a wonderful purpose. And I've always looked at it that way. There's kind of the difference, if you will. Husbands, you're the corralware. Wives, you're the nice fancy dishes. You know what I'm saying? That's kind of the way that goes. You could look at it physically speaking. Generally speaking, husbands are stronger than their wives physically speaking. Most of the time, that's the case in one way or another. Now, I know the joke with us a lot of times is there'd be times when I'm trying to open a jar or something, set it down, and Lynn comes and pops it right off of it. I'm sure I loosened it up before she got to it. But something to that effect, I don't know. But no, generally speaking, that's true. I mean, like, for instance, we do wood, and Lynn and I will go out and do wood, and Lynn will go out and do wood with me. But you can tell after a while. You can see the difference between the man and the woman as far as just the strength, as far as that goes. It's there. And I think that's what Peter was recognizing. And again, not always. Not always. You know what? I wouldn't arm wrestle Lynn. First of all, I'm a terrible arm wrestler. Anybody could beat me. If you want to look like a dude, you come arm wrestle me and you'll beat me every time. But Lynn would beat me arm wrestling. I at least the last time we tried, you know. But that's not the point of what he's getting at. But generally speaking, yes. The husband would be just a little bit stronger than the wife in that way. But there's different things that the wife needs in that regard. First of all, I believe from a biblical perspective, a wife needs protection. I think that we as men are the protectors of our wives and our children. And if you don't have the muscle to protect them, then get the concealed carry permit or whatever you need to do. You know, but yeah, I believe we are the protectors. And we protect. And by the way, I have a concealed carry thing. I usually won't tell you when I'm carrying. I'm not carrying right now. I don't like to carry when I preach. But that has more to do with the fact that my pants don't stay up very well and I got heavy things in them. So, you know. But one of the reasons why I do that is I take that whole thing seriously. I want to protect my family. And I want to protect them. I'm not looking to get into a gun battle with anyone. I'm not looking to prove anything with anybody. In fact, most of the time if I'm carrying, you'll never know it. Or at least I won't say anything about it. But if something comes up, I want to be able to protect them. And I think that's part of our role as husbands. We are protectors. Now, does that mean that they can't protect us? Lynn has a gun, too, and hers has a lot more rounds in it than mine does. But she doesn't carry. So, at least not regularly. So, again, I believe that's our role, though. We are protectors. We need to do that. Well, another thing that wives need to be provided for. Now, I know in our culture, usually both spouses are working, and I know in here there's a mixture of some where they both do, some where they don't. But whether they're both working or not is beside the point. They need to be provided for. We need to make sure that they've got the things that they need. They need a safe home. They need stocked shelves. They need to make sure that the bills are paid. They need to maybe have some future plans, some things we're looking forward to that need to be done, all of those types of things. We need to make sure, men, that we're not being foolish going off buying all the stuff that we want and then making it to where things are so tight on our wives that our wives are not at ease because of that. We need to make sure that they're being provided for. Wives need strength. And we already talked about the physical idea there that men add strength. But what about emotional strength? I believe wives help husbands just as much as husbands help wives. But husbands, are we helping in that area? Are we helping to give emotional strength? Or are we just saying, just a woman? We shouldn't be doing that. We need to be helping with those things. And we need to be seeing that there's emotional strength. Just like the idea, and Lynn and I have never had to face this, but I've seen people that have, that if I kept getting together with my family, and if there were people in my family that were kind of abusive toward Lynn for whatever reason, and by the way, my family loves Lynn. When you live as far away as we do, we're the favorite ones. We're not around enough to make them mad at us, so when we are there, they all love us. But if I was around them and some of them were treating her badly, I wouldn't let that happen. That's not going to happen. even if it meant that we're not going to be there at some family gatherings, because I'm not going to let them treat her that way. She needs to feel that protection. She needs to have that emotional awareness that I'm aware of that. And I'm not going to just put up with it because that's my family. But, you know, there are some families that blood is thicker than water, right? And I get that. But boy, oh boy, you know what? Your first priority is your wife. It's not your mom and dad. It's not your brothers or sisters. It's not the others. Your first priority is your wife. And you need to make sure that you're helping to take care of her as far as that is concerned. So we need to do that. So husbands, we need to recognize them as the weaker vessels. But let's go on here in verse 7 of 1 Peter. He also says that you need to treat them as being heirs together in the grace of life. We need to honor our wives as fellow heirs in the grace of life. Well, what does grace of life mean? I believe, generally speaking, grace of life means that God has created life so that there is some goodness in life. And we experience the goodness of life together. But I believe there's a couple of ways that happens. First of all, spiritually speaking, we enjoy the grace of life together, especially when we're both believers. We both have inherited eternal life. We are both equal in Jesus Christ, and that is certainly true. And that's one of the problems that people have when they're hammering against any type of a submission type talk, is they're thinking that we're putting someone down. We're not doing that. We're equal. In before the Lord Jesus Christ, we are equal. Just like that sergeant and corporal in the military, if one of them harms the other one in a criminal way, it doesn't matter what rank you are, you both have certain rights before the law, and you both stand equal before the law, and you both get equal protection. That person doesn't have the right to murder you, even if they are higher ranking than you. It doesn't matter. You're equal in the law. Well, that's how it is with us spiritually speaking. We are equal before the Lord. We're both brothers and sisters in Christ, and we certainly appreciate that, and we enjoy that relationship. We're both servants of Jesus Christ. We serve God together, and that's the heirs of the grace of life. We serve the Lord together. We're reaching for the same goal, spiritually speaking. That doesn't mean that we might each have our own goals on different things, but together, we're both striving to walk with the Lord. We're both striving to get to the other side together, to where we'll be with the Lord in eternity and so forth. But yes, we're receiving spiritual blessings together. Well, there's also the earthly life as far as the grace of life. And I believe Peter might have had this more in mind than even the spiritual thing, where we're heirs together of the grace of life. God created marriage. God created Adam and Eve to be together. If you were to be asked, why did God create Eve for Adam? And you were to ask, what is the real situation? Some people might say, well, God did that so that we could have children. Did you know that is not the number one reason given in the scriptures as to why God created marriage? I mean, having children is a result of marriage, for sure, down the road most of the time. But that's not why. When you read in the scriptures on why God created Eve and for Adam, it has more to do with companionship. God looked at Adam and he was alone and it wasn't good. And God created Eve to be with him. So that is the grace of life. God created them to be life companions, life togetherness in that way. And he created Eve to be a help to Adam. To help, because Adam had things to do that God wanted him to do, and God wanted Adam to have a partner so that together they could get them done, and they could do those things. That's the helping part. Now, that doesn't mean that he's not helping her, because certainly, according to what Peter's talking about here, understanding their needs, we certainly are doing it. So the help goes both ways. But God created them for a companionship and for helping in life as they go through this life. And when a husband and wife realize what they've got in that case, wonderful things can happen. When they approach life from that perspective, life can be beautiful as they have that time together. That's that grace of life that Peter is talking about here. Now, husbands, you need to understand that your wives are joint heirs with you. We're joint heirs. Just because God does give husbands one set of responsibilities and wives another, and the husbands, that you look at the headship thing, that doesn't mean that they're more important in God's eyes. It doesn't mean anything like that. It means that God just gave you a job. You need to do your job. But together, we are heirs together. We are joint heirs. And husbands, we need to respect our wives in that sense, and we need to appreciate them for that. It's not a thing where wives are for men. And by the way, that's just another issue. I've got all kinds of thoughts going through my head. I'm trying to say all kinds of things right now. You've heard me say before, sometimes when I watch I Love Lucy, Whitney's got all 9 seasons of I Love Lucy, and they're funny to watch. But it makes me so mad to see how Ricky does some of the things that he does. And they had an old-fashioned idea back there in the culture that men were over the women. Did you know the Bible never says men are over women? In fact, the Bible never tells women to submit to men. What the Bible says is wives submit to your husbands. Big difference. It's not a thing about men being over women, because they're not. They're equal in all other respects. But within the family environment, this is how God wanted it to operate. And so that's how it's operating. But men, we're equal together, and so we need to understand that. We need to treat our wives as a valued ally in life. And we're going through this thing together. I love, in the New Testament, you look at certain couples. I think of Aquila and Priscilla that served together. You always see them together. You see them as they helped Paul. Remember, they were tent makers with Paul, and so they served together like that. And then they traveled around because of their jobs and so forth. But in different places, when you see them, it's like, I don't know if they started the church or just there were churches where they were that just started meeting in their homes. It seemed like they always had that, a church in their home. There was a young preacher named Apollos that was trying to preach. They pulled him aside, and they together helped disciple him, and he became one of the greatest preachers in the early church. But they did it together, you see? They were together on those things. And husbands, we need to understand that. We need to understand that our wives are together with us. And you know what? That's where the concept of submission comes in. Peter doesn't use the word submission here. He did with wives, where he talks about wives submitting to their own husbands. He doesn't use the word submission, but the concept of submission is there. We have to submit to the needs of our wives. We have to submit to the responsibility of taking care of our wives. They're not just an added asset that God has given to help us get things done, you know. And when your hammer breaks, you throw it away and get a new hammer and just keep on going. That's not the way we look at wives. No, it's more important than that. It's bigger than that. And we have to submit to that. And frankly, if your hammer breaks, you can throw it away and get a new one. But when your wife breaks, you can't throw her away and get a new one. At least you're not supposed to. And instead, you're there for the healing. You're there for the caring. That's why when you see a couple spouses, especially as they get later in years, and maybe the wife has terrible dementia and she's just bedridden all the time and nothing, and yet you see a husband who stays there caring for her needs. And so I appreciate that the way it should be, because they're important. And the same vice versa is true with the wife caring for the husband's needs and those things. We've got to care for each other. But husbands, we have to submit to that. There are some husbands that don't want to do that. There are some husbands that think that life is about them, and life is about them having adventures, that life is about them pursuing their hobbies and getting the things that they want. And there's nothing wrong with having hobbies. There's nothing wrong with going on adventures. But there is when those things are more important than your wife. That ought not to be. You submit to the care of your wife. And that's what you need to do. And that's where all of us need to go. Now, I'm assuming that some of your husbands are feeling like I do. I feel woefully deficient in this. And I know that there's times when I fail, and we can sense it. And I know all of us go through those things. But that's where you get back up, keep moving forward, and strive for the right thing. And that's what we're to do. We have to submit to that responsibility. There's times when you might feel like this, then she's an emotional wreck and it's pulling me down. Well, you know what? You're a part of that you're in the same boat together, so she's going down, yeah, go down with her. And then somewhere along the line, you'll swim back to the top together. But that's what you need to do. That's where the submission part from a husband perspective is there. Now, as I mentioned before, you have to be careful. Husbands are never told to demand that their wives submit to them. And wives, likewise here, you're never told to demand that your husband submits to your needs and to your care. But it's expected that both of you will do that. Now, wives are to voluntarily submit to their husband's headship. Husbands are to voluntarily submit to the care of their wives. And if we both do those things, we get something beautiful. Now, we're all human, we're all sinners, and so that creates a lot of this at times, but that's all right. We work through that, and that's what we're supposed to do. But we submit to each other. Now, put it in the context that Peter has here. Their world's coming under persecution. The Christians are about to become more and more persecuted by the Roman government. And they're going to be hammered out. And so that's going to make it socially acceptable to persecute believers around you because you're treating them like they're lowlifes. Well, how do you respond? Well, one of the things, and he mentions a number of different things already we've looked at, responding to your employers, responding to the government officials over you. He's mentioned all those things. But how do you respond to each other? Guess where the one safe place is that we have? It's in our home. And we need to make this work right because we're going to need each other more than ever before. And so we need to make this right as we submit to each other. I believe that's what Peter has in mind here. Yes, it'll be a testimony. Our wives with unsaved husbands can reach out to their unsaved husbands in that way. Husbands with unsaved wives can reach out to their wives in that way. But where you got two believers together, they create that haven, create that safe place for each other, for their kids. And who knows what's going to happen to them? Who knows how many of them were persecuted terribly? I haven't done the study on it, but it was coming. And we don't know if it'll happen to us or not, but if it ever does, we need to make sure that we've got this right. We've got this one haven together. And I will say this, the safest place I feel in the whole world is with Lynn and Whitney. It's not necessarily in our house. I mean, I like our house, but if our house burns down or whatever, I'm still going to have that haven of Lynn and Whitney. And one day Whitney will probably be out on her own, and it'll just be Lynn and I, but I've got that safe place. I've got that haven, and we need to create that for each other so that we can endure whatever the Lord so decides to allow us to go through. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Peter's words here as he encourages these early believers to represent you well, to fill their roles and be in their place, whatever you're going to allow in their place. Thank you for that. And I pray that you'd help us too as we progress. Who knows what's going to happen in our world, but where we are right now, our families are our safe spots. Help us to nurture those safe spots. Help us to make those safe spots work well for us and give an example to those coming along behind us as well. Thank you, Father. I'm praying this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing one more song together. Hymn number 319, Blessed Assurance. 319, and you can remain seated.
Purchase of God, born of His.
May the Lord bless your afternoon.